that with me. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, y'all. Praise the Lord. We glorify you, God. We thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Anybody really need it, though? Jesus, we need to encourage one another, and we need to make sure that we give God all the glory and the praise. And so I'm going to challenge you one more time. Give him glory.
Hallelujah.
Turn to Psalms. We're going to Psalm 46. And when we hit Psalm 46, just while you're getting there, we're going to be going to 1, 2, 3, and then 10. So if you want to mark it, highlight it in the electronics, anything you want to do, we want to do that at this time. Psalm 46. 1, 2, 3, and 10. When you got it, all you got to do is look up. Amen. What do you do? Hey, that'll preach right there. When you got it, look up. When you got God's word, all you got to do is look up. Hey, that's faith. Y'all don't understand, I'm preaching. And the word. That'll preach right there. When you got his word, look up. My God. I'm about to pray, Lord. I'm going to get me in order. Amen. Yes, sir. All right, so listen. This is the time when we're going to actually pray over ourselves.
Right.
We're going to actually speak in ourselves. We're actually going to acknowledge God for who he is in our life. Amen. So this is how it's going to go. And I want you to say it like you mean it to yourself and in the spirit. Amen. And you're going to be like, God is my refuge and my strength. Amen. He's my very present help in trouble. Therefore, I will not fear. Even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled through the mountains shake with its swelling, drop down to 10, I will be still and know that you are God. You will be exalted among the nations and exalted in the earth.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So that's how it's going to go, but I want you to put yourself in it and your situations in it. And whatever your mountains are, I want to make sure you acknowledge those too. So if you will, we're going to give you about 2 minutes to go through that with yourself. Amen?
Amen.
This is just for you.
Thank you.
as we go through, I still want you to just listen to that right quick. Turn that up. I need you to believe it. Put your hands together. Prayed for. I don't really have a list.
Amen.
We'll go ahead and start with names that may not be on our prayer list at this time. Anybody have anyone you want to put the sick, the shut in?
Okay.
Beverly Robinson's children.
Amen.
Sherelle Brown.
Sherelle Brown. I might read these real quick as well. For Latisha McGee, Sister Katie Cage, Sister Elizabeth Carter. I think this might be an old one. But either way, I know I've asked for Reverend Crittenden, Allison Crittenden, as well as, I don't remember the other one. I also have Sister Bobette Hobson, but isn't she doing that now? I think this is the old one, but we'll be good anyway. Any other names on the prayer?
The Rennie Short family, the Cupper. Rennie Short.
Rennie Short
and family.
And family.
Ruth Lattimore. And her daughter Lynn Perry.
And her daughter Lynn Perry.
Tom Gladney. Mm-hmm.
Vicki Jackson.
And Joe Atkins.
The Hampton and the Taylor family.
Andre Langston and the entire Langston family.
Tiana Patterson and Ike Green.
Stephanie Alexander and family.
Yes.
Phyllis Gamble and family. And Sister Lavicia McDonald.
Sister Gladys McGee.
Katie Price's family.
Peggy Price.
Peggy Price and family. Any other known?
Craig family, McCovery family.
The Craig and the McCovery family.
Frank McCullough. Sister Ruth Walker.
Frank McCullough.
Sister Ruth Walker.
Sister Ruth Walker.
Sister Cynthia Smith.
Sister Cynthia Smith.
My brother, did I say John Etchison?
John Etchison.
Sister Gladys McGee.
Sister Gladys McGee.
Sister Mary Frances Sanders.
Sister Mary Frances Sanders.
Brother Joseph Caldwell.
Brother Joseph Caldwell.
Brother Denzel Grandison.
Brother Denzel Grandison. As you have left.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Did you, Sister Gwen Pad, is she?
She, no.
She okay?
We requested her to be taken off. Yeah, I just gotta get an updated list.
Okay.
Yes, this.
My cousin Emma Isis.
Emma Isis?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The Gibson and Lowe families.
The Gibson and Lowe families.
Yes, ma'am. And Sister Bishop McDonald.
Bishop McDonald.
That's it.
Amen.
William Lee Spicer family.
William Lee Spicer family.
My son-in-law, Rick Mason.
Rick Mason. That's the other one was on there.
In the camp.
Sister Curtis's brother-in-law, Walter.
Okay, Sister Curtis's brother-in-law, Walter.
Terry Harris and the Harris family.
Terry Harris and the Harris family.
And I have a actually a personal prayer. Y'all can pray for me. I go for a kidney evaluation in the morning.
All right, Brother Tori, and his evaluation in the morning.
Amen.
Yes.
Ma'am. Macedonia Church family.
The Macedonia Church family.
Amen.
Rodney Manning's mother.
Rodney Manning's mother.
And their family.
And their family.
And Josh and Rosie Wiki.
And Josh and Rosie Wiki. Amen.
A special prayer for our college students.
Amen.
Special prayer for our college students.
All of our children. All of our children.
Sister Chantel Johnson.
Sister Chantel Johnson.
And the Kemp family.
And the Kemp family.
Amen. Those grandparents that are raising teenagers.
Those grandparents that are raising teenagers. And those parents who are raising teenagers. Amen. I'm going to add to that one. Amen. And let's pray for those teenagers. Because they be thinking I'm the one just needs a prayer. But you know what? Amen. Definitely continue to pray for the Riley and the Johnson family.
Jimmy Harris.
Any other I'm missing?
Ronnie Wright family.
Ronnie Wright's family, definitely.
Amen.
Amen.
The McKenzie family.
As Pastor would say, bless your heart. You like him, right? Anybody else? Amen.
The Birches and the Bowsers.
Amen. The Birches and the Bowsers. And I want to actually ask a special prayer for the Spicer family.
Amen.
Atkins family. Amen. Anybody else? Yeah.
The Anglin family.
The Albion community. And I really want, I don't live here, but I do want to pray for your city council.
Amen.
And manager. Amen. I don't really lift them up. I walk past a little sheet of paper with Albion recording and stuff. We're going to need that. Amen. So lift them up. Anybody else? Are we all set?
Up top. Bethel Baptist Church.
Amen. Bethel Baptist Church.
And the City of Albion.
And the City of Albion. Amen. All right. So at this time, if you'll get with your partner, we want to keep those names lifted up in prayer. Again, we're going to read in Isaiah 53. We're going to start with 4. We want to personalize it to make sure we actually call the names out. If you can remember any of the names, we want to keep them in heart and mind as we go in prayer. But please grab a partner, and we'll give you about 3 minutes to do that together.
Donation. your family.
Then it says, give me understanding.
Oh, yeah.
Amen. And I shall keep your law. So we're saying that if we understand it, then we're going to do it.
Amen.
Now, I don't want anybody in here not telling the truth.
Amen.
So that's why we're saying it out loud. So it says, give me understanding, and I shall keep your law. Indeed, I shall observe it with my what?
Whole heart.
So you can't just give them a little bit.
Nope.
So when you speak this one, you have to be ready to move. Amen?
Amen.
It says, make me. Uh-oh.
Wow.
Y'all not going to have a problem saying make me.
Nope.
It says, make me to walk in the path of your commandments. Mine is the New King James Version. Do y'all say something different? It does say make me. Okay, I want to make sure y'all version said make me. Because we want to say, Lord, make me walk in the path of your commandments. For I delight where? In it. So as I walk and doing what you're saying, that's where I actually get my delight. Then also, incline my heart to your testimony. And not to covetousness. So it said, I don't want to be worried about all that bad stuff, that sin. I want to just delight in who you are and what you are. That's where I want my heart to be. And guess what? We also will give him power over our eyes. Where it says, turn away my eyes from looking at worthless things. And revive me in your way. So whenever I'm off, pump me up in the right way, Lord. Because I don't want to be wrong. Y'all don't have to mean it, though. Then it talks about the mouth. Somebody say,
uh-oh.
It says, establish your word to your servant. I need to make sure that the words that I'm speaking, that I speak, are his words, who is devoted to fearing you. So my fear won't be, I won't be worried about what man's doing.
Amen.
The only one I'm fearing is
the Lord.
The Lord. So I got to watch the word. I got to get the word in me so that way when it comes out of my mouth, the only thing I'm worried about is him and pleasing him. Turn away my reproach, which I dread, for your judgments are good. Behold, I long for your precepts. Revive me in your righteousness. Y'all got that?
Yeah.
Now you're going to personalize it again. You give it to your partner, but you're going to have to speak that thing over your life. And it means when you say it, you're going to have to say it like you're ready to do exactly that.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, God, I really want you to do this thing.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to turn my eyes. I want you to open my ears. I want you to change my heart. I want you to do all of this. Make me. When you get to the point where you can say, make me, you doing something. Amen. So we're going to say it today. Amen.
Amen.
All right, I'm going to give you a good 2 minutes, at least maybe three on that one. Yes, we got a question first.
Will we pray stand?
And that's what I meant to mention. I'm so happy you mentioned it. I was like, Pastor is going to get me because only Tori stood. You stood on the first one. He stood on the second one. Y'all stood. Okay, y'all stand.
All right, y'all.
Okay, all right. Y'all stand. And make sure when you stand it, that means it's going to give you some vigor. Don't get me in trouble.
He back there looking at me, watching.
He's back down.
Thank you. 30 seconds.
Yes, ma'am.
Five seconds. You still praying? Keep on praying. Well, good evening, everybody.
Hello, Pastor.
So good to see your lovely faces. It's been a, seemed like forever since I seen you, even though it's just been since Sunday. It's good to see everybody.
Yes.
I miss you, especially you, but I miss all of you. All of you. Praise God. Thank God for Minister Spicer, if you don't mind giving her applause. We got time for one more prayer, and then we'll do some other stuff. And so, our prayer of salvation, Luke chapter 19, Luke 19 and 10. So I am under the impression you prayed for the family.
Yes,
sir. So the family is well. You prayed for the sick and shut in, and now everybody's. That's sick and shut in, they ain't gonna be sick and they ain't gonna be shut in. And if they have to be shut in, they're gonna be well while they shut in.
Yes,
pray for the Lord to teach you some things.
Yes.
Teach you the way of his statutes. And then you made a commitment by reading the scripture that you want to observe it with your whole heart and say something about your mouth. Lord have mercy. So your family's good, everybody's healed, now you good. Now let's get somebody saved.
Yeah.
And we don't want to forget what business we're in the church. So Luke 19 and 10. Luke 19:10. We're in the same business that Jesus is in.
Yeah.
And so when we understand what business Jesus was in, we'll know what business we're in. The Bible says in Luke 19:10, for the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Seek and to save that which was lost. I can't help it. Let me bother this other thing real quick. Let me show you something real quick. Seek and to save that which was lost. Turn, you're in Luke chapter 19. Turn real fast to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. Sister Spicer done got us up with good time, and I ain't going to take up all the time, but I want to show you just one little thing here. Jesus is in the seeking and saving business, which means that we're in the seeking and saving business. All right? We're in the seeking, and we bring them to the one that can save them, right? So watch this. Luke chapter 15, let me just paraphrase it so I won't take up all the time. You have three parables in Luke 15. Three different parables, Sister Bree, of something that's lost. Watch this. In verse number 3 down to verse number 7, you got the parable of the lost sheep. It says, what man of you having 100 sheep, and if he lose one of them, doeth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is what?
Lost.
Until he do what?
Find it.
Until he find it. That's one thing that's lost. Then you go to the second parable, verse 8 through verse 10. You got the parable of the lost coin. It says, either what woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, do not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently till what?
She finds it.
Lord have mercy. Till she find that lost coin. Real quick, that was also a connotation or a reference to a bride, if you will, who was betrothed or engaged. So basically she was married, and the groom gave her a hat piece that had 10 coins on it. And when he comes back, he's looking for that hat piece to have all 10 of them coins. But one day, one of the coins broke away from the rest of the coins. Uh-huh. And she knew, for my boo come back, I need to find that coin. And so she went all out, Brother Torres. She was, you know what I mean, she was moving furniture. There was some furniture movement going on. She was moving furniture to find the coin. Because she had to find it, because it was imperative that she find it. Then the last parable from verse number 11 all the way down probably to the end of the chapter is the parable of the lost son. You know it as the prodigal son, but that was actually two sons that was lost.
Yes.
Lord have mercy. Yes. That was actually two. The one who stayed home was lost and the one who left was lost.
Yes.
So watch this. You can lose something in your house and looking at it all day, every day. And so just because we get people come to the house all the time don't mean they ain't lost. We're seeking and saving that which is lost. And we seek it until we do what? Until we find it. And so now if you understand that chapter 15 is actually one story broke up into three parts. It's a lost coin, a lost sheep, a lost coin, and a lost son. But it's actually one story of the lost and somebody finding it. And then Jesus, he just summed it up in Luke 19 and verse 10. He said, but the Son of Man, he's coming to seek and to save that which was lost. I don't care what was lost, he's coming to find it. And if he's in the lost, he's in the finding of the lost business, then we're in the finding of the lost business. And some of us, before we go find somebody's their salvation, we need to find our joy. We need to find our encouragement. Some of us, we need to just find a smile. Lord, find a kind word. Find a kind act of to do for someone else. Just find some joy in this holiday season.
Amen.
And make this be the best Christmas ever.
Amen.
So, while you got your little partner, I hope you got your partner. If you don't have a partner, then just get with the person right next to you. This will be okay to hang with them. Let's pray, particularly Luke chapter 19, verse 10, that everything that's lost shall be found. Everything that's lost shall be found. And if you know some people, call some names out real quick. And we want to just take 2 minutes on this one real quick. And then we're going to move on with something else. All right, ready? Go.
So we know that people find whoever's lost there, if they're coming seeking advice. So I pray that we're in the business of saving souls. The Lord says that's what He commanded us to do. That's priority number one. We don't want to take that lightly, because that's what the business of the church is about. Going out there, finding those who are lost. Find it. If they could have, Lord, they were already with us. The Father said that the enemy is not there, he's blind, he's blind, he's blind, they don't even have a clue that they are even in the dark. So, Father, give us the kind of expectation you need. Go out and just to those people you know, have to commit to serve you. So, Lord, we just ask that you put on our hearts as we are here to share the gospel. About the Lord Jesus Christ and how we can seek and find that Lord is lost. Lord, we thank you in advance. I believe through your Holy Spirit, through your work, through your Holy Spirit. We thank you in advance. Clean in our hearts.
Seconds. 15 seconds. Amen, amen. Won't he do it? He said he would. Praise God. If you're still praying, keep on praying. But we just want to thank God for each and every one of you. Welcome to those of you who are streaming live to our prayer service. And as we transition into our Bible study, let me just bring a couple of things to your attention. And then we're going to bring our teachers up for tonight. I got so much feedback that I didn't give y'all no time last week. So I'm going to do all I can to give you your time tonight. If you don't mind, maybe we call the name out, I'm not sure, but make sure, if you will, to keep in prayerful support, or keep lifted up in prayer, Sister Tiana Patterson. So she needs our prayers right now. So, Ivan Green, I believe, is also in the hospital. So we want to make sure we lift up those individuals. I got text and call on those individuals this week. So if you don't mind, in your prayer time, add them to the names that you call off. We do have a Fifth Sunday Fellowship this month, and it's in your bulletin, but I just want to make sure all of Macedonia that can and will, if you will be joining us at Christ Apostolic Church, where Pastor Jerry Hendon will be the preacher for that occasion. This is the last Fifth Sunday Fellowship of the year, and so I think I will be introducing him, but he'll do that little preaching thing. But those who can and will join us at Christ Apostolic on the fifth Sunday at 6 p.m. And then the next night, the very next night, that's when I've been kind of pushing you guys. Well, I'll talk about that. Watch night service is going to be right here at 10 p.m. And so those of you who are familiar with how we do watch night, there's a rotation, if you will, with the three Baptist churches, predominantly African-American Baptist churches in the city of Albion, Mount Calvary, Macedonia, and Bethel, and we rotate. And so this year, the host church, if you will, is Macedonia, and the preacher for this year is Pastor Fred Alexander. And so if you remember Macedonia, we have this little testimony period of time, and trust me, before watch night service, we're going to do some training.
Amen.
On the testimonies.
Amen.
ABCs.
Amen.
ABCs of the testimonies.
Yes, sir.
We ain't going to do a whole lot of it tonight, but we're going to do the ABCs of testimonies so that we're ready, and then we'll make sure that our guests, and I probably need somebody from Macedonia, maybe about two or three people, to get some good testimonies ready to start off so we can train the rest of the community on how to do it.
Amen.
Sweet Lord Jesus. ABCs. Accurate. Make sure you tell the truth.
Amen.
Brief.
Amen.
You can't tell it all at one time. If it takes a lifetime to live it, you can't tell it all in a day. Nor a moment. So a good 2 minutes or so is about what it should be. And then see, at the end of it all, it wasn't really about you, it was Christ-centered. What did God do? ABC, accurate, brief, Christ-centered. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Let me thank you. No, let me ask a question. How many folks Sunday went home and got y'all some rest? Praise God, hallelujah. Praise God, since you were in the bed. I really hope you did. I hope you did. I hope you did. I wish I could have, but I hope you did. I wish I could have, but I wish I could have. And so, that being said, thank you for your prayers. Those of you who have heard my little story since I seen you on Sunday is crazy. So the idea was simple. I was to go to Grand Rapids, catch a flight, go to Chicago, catch a connecting flight, get in Mississippi, pick up a car that my aunt had that I bought from them, bring it back up because my son needed a car. Drive it back up. So I was to go from Kalamazoo to Grand Rapids, from Grand Rapids to Chicago, from Chicago to Meridian, from Meridian to Kalamazoo. Very simple.
That sounds
simple. It's very simple. Very simple.
Yes, sir.
So thank you for your prayers, because I went from Kalamazoo to Grand Rapids, mm-hmm. from Grand Rapids to Chicago, got to Chicago, and the flight got canceled.
Oh, my goodness.
I stayed in the airport all night long.
Oh, wow.
Very cold and loud.
Wow.
You know you can't lay down in the airport because they don't have no place for you to lay down, so I'm sitting up. Sleep when I could. At 10 o'clock on Monday, I finally get a flight. But I don't go from Chicago to Meridian. I go from Chicago to Dallas, Texas.
You're in Texas.
So I'm in Texas. I ain't nowhere near Meridian. Then I finally get a flight out of Dallas, Texas. I'm still not headed to Meridian. I'm headed to, some of you may be familiar with Mississippi, I'm headed to Hattiesburg, Mississippi.
I heard that. Yeah.
Hattiesburg is not Meridian.
No.
So I get to Hattiesburg, but I don't have to get off the plane, so that's a good thing. But Brother Ronnie, they get me to Hattiesburg, I got to sit on the plane for another, 15, 20, 30 minutes or whatever. I got to sit there. Then we get in the air again, and 10 minutes later, we land in Meridian. Now, you'd have thought they could have just took me to Meridian.
Yeah, right.
And then from Meridian, I get in the car, and then I start my track up, and I arrive back in Kalamazoo at about 11 something yesterday morning, and I have been sleepy ever since. And so I thank God for your prayers, Macedonia. Thank God for your prayers. And so we're very thankful for that. So it is 7:15. We have some teachers who are prepared tonight. And so I'm not going to take up any more of your time because I am tired. And this is the only time you'll hear me talk about I'm tired, because I'm not teaching tonight. If I was teaching, you wouldn't hear me talk about I'm tired. Let me just hurry up and tell our congregation something. And let me probe your memory. In the 40 years that I've been here, have you ever heard me, when I got a teacher preach, get up before you and say, I'm tired or I'm sick?
No.
No, sir.
Not even.
No.
The only reason you were here tonight is because I ain't teaching.
Amen.
You didn't say that when you were sick on
Watchman. I thought I was going to the emergency room right after that. And we're going to say, so our teachers and our preachers have been trained that you, the congregation, don't need to hear their problem.
No.
Nope.
Amen.
You came for a word. You didn't come to hear, well, you know, I'm tired tonight. And I ain't feeling good tonight. No, they tired. They ain't feeling good. They need a word from you. And so the only reason you're hearing about me being tired at all is I ain't preaching or I ain't teaching tonight. So let's bring our teachers up. We got two very capable teachers who are on the scene tonight. They're going to tag team it. They have from now, which is 7:15, because that clock is moving fast. And they have until 7:55. Because I need to give me 5 minutes back.
Amen.
And without further ado, our first teacher for the night is none other than Mr. Cedric Lewis.
Cedric!
And since I don't need to come back until the end, he will be followed by First Lady Justine McKenzie.
Amen.
Good evening.
Good evening.
First, giving honor to God, who is my everything, to his son, Jesus Christ, for paying only the price that he could pay, so that I would be able, and we would be able to enjoy paradise with him.
Amen.
To the angel of this house, my spiritual father, your spiritual father, my big brother, senior pastor, Bobby McKenzie. Thank God for bringing him back safe and sound. My goodness, to my teacher partner tonight, but you know her as the First Lady of this house.
Amen.
First Lady Justine McKenzie.
Amen.
Amen. And to you. Yes, back it up. And to you, my brothers and my sisters, Pastor, thank you for giving me the opportunity to share a word. And that word today is titled A Kept Promise.
All right.
Coming from Jeremiah chapter 29. Verses 10 through 14.
Amen.
And if you would, please turn there with me. We greatly appreciate it. Amen. So the King James Version of the Bible reads, "For thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you in causing you to return to this place. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. And ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. And I will be found of you, saith the Lord. And I will turn away your captivity, and I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places whither I have driven you, saith the Lord. And I will bring you again into the place whence I caused you to be carried away captive." The word of God. So our aim tonight is to encourage believers that God always keeps his promises. Amen. So let me see if I can secure your interest. How many of us have ever made a promise we just couldn't keep? Amen. Amen. No matter how good our intentions were, something came up. And we could not make good on our promise. Whether it was a promise to help a friend or family member move into their new house, keep a dinner date with our significant other, or going to an event at the kid's school, real life happened, and you just can't make it. You volunteer to work in the kitchen here at MMBC, and that same week, you get put on mandatory overtime for the next month. Just couldn't make it. You commit to teach a class at Vacation Bible School, only to find out that you have been moved to second shift for the entire summer because the company you work for needs your expertise in another department. Better yet, you give Pastor McKenzie your word that you will attend Sunday school every week, only to find yourself still involved with the mattress ministry during the Sunday school hour. Amen. Thank you. Now let's look at this from the other side of the coin. How many of us have made a promise not to do something again, only to find ourselves doing the exact thing we said we would never do anymore? My goodness. Some of these promises we don't just make to man, but we make these to Jesus Christ himself. Yes, sir. Can you find yourself a people you know in these promises? Number one, Lord, if you get me out of this relationship, I will never date someone like him or her again, only to go back to that same abusive person or actively pursue someone who is the spitting image of our ex in looks and behaviors. My God. Yes, sir. Number two, Lord, if you help me this one time, I promise never to drink Hennessy or Grey Goose again, only to find yourself in Nikki's Lounge in the Deep, turning up with your friends the following weekend. My God. So, number three, for all the students in the house, Lord, if you let me get a good grade on this final exam so I can pass this class, I promise to study harder next semester. My God. I got a couple more. I'm going to beat you up too bad, but I do got a couple more. This is for the grown, unmarried folk in the house. Lord, I promise never to sleep with that girl or that guy again. Only to have a weak and lonely moment. And you end up inviting them over just to talk.
All right now.
Number five, this is my personal favorite right here, and I thank Sister Mary Ann and Brother Brother Philip and Brother Tory, they can agree with us after what transpired this past Saturday. Lord, if you heal me of this thing, I promise to take better care of the temple than you bless me with. Only to go back to eating stuff that Dr. Katar would have a fit about if he knew I was doing it.
Amen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Even the person with the highest level of kingdom character and kingdom integrity can fall short at times. Our best intentions, sometimes, in the words of Senior Pastor Bobby McKenzie, do not amount to a hill of beans. I hope I have secured your interest. Amen.
Amen.
So as we transition, the Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines the word keep as fulfill or observe, with a past tense of the word being kept. The dictionary also defines the word promise as a pledge to do or not to do something specified. So if we were to combine this phrase, kept promise, it means that a pledge to do or not to do something specified has been fulfilled. My goodness. Saints, we can take comfort in knowing that God always has, always is, and always will keep his promises. In the heavenly places, those promises have already been fulfilled. In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, the Apostle Paul tells us, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us, has blessed, past tense, already did, with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world," before, past tense, "that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will." My brothers and my sisters, we are simply waiting for human history and our time in it to catch up with what God has already done. So, through lesionic presentation, as told in the letter from the prophet Jeremiah to the exiles of Judah who were living in Babylon, in Jeremiah 29, verses 10 through 14, I would like to highlight three reasons why we as believers can be encouraged that God has kept his promises. Amen. Amen. Point number one, or reason number one, the Lord said so. Verses 10, 11, and 14. We have confidence that when God speaks, he does what he says he is going to do. He has a proven track record of keeping his word. We serve a God who spoke the heavens and earth into existence. See Genesis chapter 1. If the Lord says so, then it shall be. In Jeremiah chapter 29, from verses 4 through verses 36, 30 to verse 32, the phrase, "saith the Lord," is mentioned 16 times, closely followed by the decree, "I will." He means what he says, and he says what he means. There's no guesswork with the Lord. He does not give hints or suggestions. He gives commands and instructions. And if we don't heed his commands and instructions, then there will be some consequences and repercussions as a result of our actions or lack thereof. His word is his bond. It is money in the bank. My God. Thank you. Point number two. Roll it. There is a time delay. Verse 10.
the first part of verse 10 says, "For thus said the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon." I'm stopping right there.
What?
I'm stopping right there.
7 years.
Oftentimes in a believer's life, God cannot take us directly from where we are to where He wants us to be. There must be a time for growth. A time for cleaning and pruning. There must be a time for correction. A time for getting the world out of us and getting more of the Word into us.
All right.
God was very specific with his time limit on the nation of Judah. He knows how long it's going to take to get all the junk out of us.
Amen.
So that we can actually be used for production in his kingdom.
Right.
The Lord was not going to allow the nation of Judah to return to the land he promised them until they had fulfilled their time in captivity in Babylon. Although he had promised to perform his good word toward them, they still had to endure the punishment of their previous disobedience.
Oh, yeah. All
right, now I'm going to tell you, this is going to pinch a little bit. I'm going to ask you a question, and please don't grunt. Don't lift your hand, don't do none of that. Don't tell on yourself, okay? Can we agree on that? Don't tell on yourself tonight, all right? Here go the question. How many of us here at Macedonia know that the reason why we are getting spanked in a certain area of our life is because of our direct disobedience to what God told us to do a while ago? Y'all ain't hear me. How many of us are getting whooped because of flat out disobedience? God has came and told us. Not only did he tell us, but he gave us confirmation of what to do. And we flat out said, "Lord, I ain't doing that. I'm scared. I'm lazy. I just don't want to do it. My friends may talk about me. Hey, my spouse might look at me funny. Lord, I ain't doing that." And he said, "Okay, little boy, little girl, you're going to keep going through this until you do what I told you to do." Whether it's coming to church on a regular basis, whether it's serving in a particular ministry, hey, whether it's just simply tithing and offering, doing right with the money that he blessed you to go get. Come on.
Right.
Come on now. Y'all got to be here.
Uh-huh.
Some of us are catching it because of our disobedience, just like the nation of Judah did for their disobedience. And God was not going to let them out of captivity until they learned their lesson. Amen. My goodness. We roll.
Amen.
Reason number three.
All right.
The gift of an expected end. Verse 11. The Lord knows the end game. He knows our lives from beginning to end. Romans 8:28 has to come to pass. For his children. For all his children. He promised that he would never leave us nor forsake us. He promised that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. He promised to keep us in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on him. He always makes good on his promises. If he told you he was going to do something, he's going to do it. My goodness. We have the confidence in him. We can count on him. When we can't count on anybody else, when we honestly can't even count on ourselves to do the right thing, we can count on Jesus to be there for us. Come on. My goodness. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
My God. Now, as I hit the highway, as I close, I want to stay in this teacher moment. Mrs. Spicer, this is a lesson. This is not a sermon. This is a teaching moment. I have to stay in the teaching moment. This is a teaching. This ain't a preaching. Jesus has been keeping his promises since before the beginning of time. As believers in Jesus Christ, we have confidence that what he tells us, he will do for us. Even when things don't look like they are going to work out for our good. Once again, this is a lesson. This is not a sermon. This is a lesson. This is not a sermon. But if it was a sermon,
come on, man.
I'm going to tell you that he was beat.
While there are some females that have very strong tones of voice, that is not my testimony, and I don't want y'all to miss anything. Amen?
Amen.
Because I'm so excited. I'm so thankful. Pastor, thank you so much for allowing me to teach tonight.
Amen.
Thank you so much for counting it not robbery to teach me in teacher's training and refresher training how to teach at Macedonia. Amen.
Amen.
So Macedonia is a special, special place.
Absolutely.
Amen. Amen. So I don't take that for granted. The other thing I do not take for granted is being tag team partners with MIT Cedric Lowe tonight. Amen, amen. Yes, please, everyone. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
To God be the glory.
Yeah.
Amen, because that was a word.
Yeah.
I'm holding on to my notes. I hope y'all do the same thing. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. So, tonight, the lesson that I would like to share with you, my brothers and sisters, is work your faith. So I'm assuming from the beginning you already got some faith to work. I'm thinking that I'm talking to some Christians tonight. I'm thinking that I am before people who understand God is real, Jesus is Lord, heaven is in view, and that's what we're here to talk about. so we already got some faith. Amen?
Amen.
And we want to work our faith.
Amen.
The scriptures for tonight, primarily Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. Mm-hmm. And then we have a few anchor scriptures, John chapter 5.